Pearline Brenda Eversley, aged 84, also known as Sister Eversley, late of Hythe Gardens, Christchurch, and formerly of Birmingham, UK, faithful member of the Collymorock Nazarene Church, founder and leader of the Friendship Choir of Collymorock Nazarene Church, wife of the late Sidney Eversley, mother of John and Colin Eversley, grandmother of Leon, Joshua, Miles, Daniel, and Jonathan Eversley, great-grandmother of Shanae and Cian, mother-in-law of Allison Eversley, sister of Wilma Lashley, Emile Miley Wickham and Wendy Lashley, all of Canada, aunt of Juliet O'Connor, Olembe and Aisha Wickham, cousin of Shirley, Michael and Jennifer Cook, Darnley and Evelyn Young, sister-in-law of the late Merv Thorne and Eric Wickham, relative of the extended Lashley and Eversley families, friend of too many to mention of the UK, Europe, Canada, and USA. The funeral of Pearline Brenda Eversley leaves the Belmont Funeral Home, Belmont Road, St. Michael, on Saturday, March 23rd, 2024, at 11:30 a.m. for Collymorock Church of the Nazarene, where relatives and friends are asked to meet at 1 p.m. for the service. The funeral will then proceed to the Coral Ridge Memorial Gardens for the interment. The service and burial may be viewed via live stream at www.belmontfuneralhome.live/Pearline Eversley.
A waitress treated her so good that she had to go back there and keep her parties just to be there to see that waitress. Every birthday, I can safely look out and listen out for Miss Eversley to be on the phone with me and singing me the birthday song. I mean, she loved to sing. She loved life. Mrs. Eversley, thank you for the time we had together and all that you have shared with us. Your life was a blessing. Your memories will remain in our hearts. Rest in peace, my beloved friend. You are gone, but never forgotten. And now I'm going to sing this last song for my friend and my family.
If I saw you in heaven, would you be the same? If I saw you in heaven, I must be strong and carry on. Cause I know I don't belong here in heaven. Would you hold my hand if I saw you in heaven? Would you help me stand if I saw you in heaven? I'll find my way through night and day. Cause I just can't stay here in heaven. Time can bring you down. Time can bend your knees. Time can break your heart. Have you begging, there's peace, I'm sure, and I know there'll be no more tears in heaven. Would you know? If I saw you in heaven, would you be the same? If I saw you in heaven, beyond the door, there's peace, I'm sure. And tears.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Michael Cook, and I will be reading a tribute written by Juliet O'Connor of Bermuda, niece of Pearline Eversley, and my cousin. I'm reading this because she could not be present here today. Dear Auntie Pearline, I am at a loss for words. Yes, your niece, the chatterbox, the one who can hold her own in a conversation with anyone, is at a loss for words. I don't think I will be able to write and refer to you in the past tense, because frankly, the Lashley women in my life are larger than life. That life, that energy, that comes straight from the Father's throne room in heaven is unmatched. Although you are no longer with us physically, your presence can be felt over vast distances. Growing up in Canada, I considered you to be my British aunt, the mother of my big brother British cousins with the fancy accents. Despite the distance that separated us, you were a part of my revered Fantastic Four. Your presence was felt. You, Mummy Wilma, Auntie Emily, and Wendy were and still are my superheroes. You followed the example that Granny set and did an incredible job of being an excellent wife to Uncle Sidney, a nurturing mother to John and Colin, beloved grandmother to your grandchildren, and a fun-loving and caring aunt to your nieces and nephews. Also, a giving and loving friend to so many. You, Auntie Pearline, are the epitome of the Proverbs 31 woman. Thank you for the special treats you brought me all the way from the UK when I was younger. It's still a fond memory. And for being my accomplice when I wanted to surprise Mommy for her milestone birthday. I will also treasure the time I was one of the first 10 people to call you for your birthday. We all could not wait to compare numbers to see who got their call in first and what number we were. Thank you for never missing a birthday and for every time you sang for me, my husband and my children. And especially thank you for singing at my wedding more than 30 years ago now. These are now all treasured, meaningful memories. Rest well, Auntie Pearline. Eugene, Zoe, Jeannie, and I will miss calling you to remember Uncle Sid, our annual call for Christmas and birthdays. I am grateful, so extremely grateful, for the love and connection that we had regardless of the oceans that divided us. You will be missed. I thank God for your love. Thank you just for being you. Love, Juliet. P.S. Guess I found some words after all. Thank you.
Good afternoon, church. As you all will know, my name is Marcel Rhoda Clark Eversley. It's not on my birth certificate, but Colin and John, Wendy Wilma, and Miley, they all know. And the late Sidney Eversley, he does know, because that's my late husband. Good afternoon again. It's with a great sadness that I hear this afternoon to say a few words on the late Pearlie Eversley. Mrs. Eversley, I have met in 2006 at this said Columbarock Church of the Nazarene at a funeral service of the late Harold Oldham. When I came here, she ran and said, "Excuse me, is this D. Marcel Rhoda Clark?" The gentleman who was with me, which was Mr. Clyde Odell, he said, "Yes, but let me sit her down first, and then you can come and talk with her." And that was that evening. When I came out, I thought everything would have been over. She came back, and she said, "I want your number. I need to connect with you." And from that day till this time around now, Miss Eversley is gone, we were together. So you can count the years. That is your homework, 2006 to 2024. Miss Eversley was a great woman. When I tell you a great woman, we talk every night around a quarter to 10 or 10 o'clock. The only time we would not talk is if I was going out and I would be late. So when I come in so late, I wouldn't want to call her. Nor she the same wouldn't want to call me when going to a little party in the Hoyt Garden vicinity. She would always give me some instruction, and she even welcomed me to come and join the senior friendship group. That time I was a young girl. But I still come along, and in coming along, I get to meet with Sid. He would always put his hat next to him so that when I come in, if I come late, he would move the cat and I would sit next to him. So he would see how good the connection was. I want to tell you that Mrs. Eversley loved to give. She would give you whatever she have, even if she leave it herself. If she's going to give us some workers, she have 6 parcel out in a little bag. 6 limes, another bag. 2 peppers, them in another bag. She never mixed up anything, you know, everything separated. That was Miss Eversley for you, and your friends became Miss Eversley's friend. She would never leave me out either when she have on a function, whether it be party, wedding, anniversary, or funeral, whatever it is, Miss Eversley would have me to be there, and she want me to tell me, "You got to say so few words here." I tell her, "Not, Miss, no, I can't." She said, "No, you got to, no, you're telling me that, you got to say a few words." I could hear her voice telling me that now. And I would always attend these things. So being so close to her, she was able to meet some of my friends, which are Mrs. Jean Gooden Franklin, Mrs. Ann Olton, and Mrs. Louie Hunt Burke, and members of the Eastern Friendship Group. She also met them, and therefore I met some of hers also, but most of all, the Friends of Golden Sands, where she will always go and have her pudding and sauce and her soup on Thursdays. And she will tell me what lovely meals they cook. So then I get connected now, and I'm belonging to Golden Sands, the second home after my home. So I'm sad that this is honest truth, but Mrs. Everly, see, I don't even know what more I could say about you, because it's so much. It would take the whole evening, and then you'll have to get a funeral service next week again. So, Pastor Holder, I have met him through Mrs. Eversley also. So it was good to know that I could be a part of the Columbarock Nazarene Church through Mrs. Eversley. I thank God for her life and for her ministry. She was a giving, loving, and caring person. She would always reach out with a postcard. So she got me into this thing that every time someone have on a little something, to give them a card, even if you don't got nothing to put in it. But give them a card. So I'm into that now, that I get a car to the smallest child now when they got an occasion, or get them a little gift. She don't matter what it is, you say, don't matter what it is still something to remember. You don't have to look at the big diamonds and gold and all that there. A gift is a gift. And what I'm telling you this afternoon, a pearl is a pearl. Pearling is a pearl, and a true pearl. So I want to say thank you all for hearing me, and on the behalf of my friends, my family, the past and present members of the Senior Friendship Group, and all my radio listeners and fans who always hear me show her up on the radio with Mrs. Burney, everything in the Hoyt Garden family. They don't know her, but they know her by name, even overseas. When I was leaving home, a gentleman, Mr. Conley Warner, he said to me, when you go, remember to the family for me, because she lives in New York. So God bless all of you. Continue to stay strong and remember Miss Eversy as Pearl. And she loved to sing. Precious Memories was her favorite song. And don't mind if they had 4 verses in that song. I don't know Miss Eversy, that she had 8. She going to sing it and sing it. I said, wait, she ain't going to stop. Oh, 8 verses, but anyhow, sung like a lark. So God bless all of you, and thank you for hearing me. I am signing out, Marcel Rudder Clark Eversley.
Bless God. Perchance anybody else want to say a few words, you can speak in 2 minutes. You're welcome to come and say those words for 2 minutes. Anybody else at this time? We have at least another 5 to 8 minutes before we start the service. Thank you. 10 minutes.
Good afternoon, everyone. I felt compelled to come up here and say a few words for Mrs. Eversley and the Eversley family. Difficult to follow some of those who have gone previously, the gentleman who sang and Marcel who spoke about. I think I calculated 18 years, but I think I'm going to outdo you a little bit. I've known Mrs. Eversley from back in the UK, and it will be in excess of 50 years. Colin and I started primary school together. So sorry, Carl, I'm showing your age. But yeah, over 50 years. And when I moved to Barbados 12 years ago, we reconnected and we always stayed in touch, either via a telephone call or I would pop around and see her. And someone mentioned, Marcel, I believe, mentioned about Mrs. Eversley always being inclusive and, you know, sharing her friends with you. And I remember one of the evenings I popped to see her, she quickly called Herlene and told Herlene to come over and meet me. And since then, we've been friends also. I'd also mention that I wasn't offered a deputy. But coming from the UK, can anybody suggest what Mrs. Eversley offered me for a drink? A cup of tea. A cup of tea, very English when it came to that. Mrs. Eversley back in the UK was exactly how she was here. She was a pillar of the community, always organizing things and bringing us together. We used to go on trips, we used to go to Blackpool. She used to arrange the coaches, food, drink. We used to go to Preston. She brought everyone together for those trips. So from the Francis family and also the King family are here from the UK. We send our love, our affection, our respect to Mrs. Eversley, and may she rest in eternal peace. We love you.
Thank you, ma'am. I just think we're going to have a tribute by way of video. I'm going to ask our multimedia person to bring up the clip, please. Thank you.
Hello, Jan. Hello. Hello, Colin. This is amazing. Hello, Jan. Hello. Hello, Colin. This is a message on behalf of the Pierce family. Hello, Jan. Hello. Hello, Colin. This is a message on behalf of the Pierce family. Ree, your lovely mum, Mrs. Eversley. Obviously, we all know her as Mrs. E. She's been like a second mother to all of us and a wonderful friend to my mum, who's obviously unable to make the funeral because she's in her home, as you know. I can say Mrs. Eversley visited our mum while we were all in England every week to make sure she was all right. And she's always told me the first person she met when she came to England was my mum. I just want to say that we are so sorry to hear of her loss. But In a way, we know she'll be with Sydney. Her favourite person is, as well, you all know. I'm just so sorry that I can't be there or any of us can be there to join you all in this sad occasion. But then in a celebration of Mrs. Eversley's life. As I said again, she's a wonderful person. No trouble. Anyone who needed help, Mrs. Eversley was always there. Always very organised, as you well know. But she'll be surely and sadly missed, especially by myself, who, like I said, she'd been like a second mother to me and the rest of the Pierce family. So I'll just wish everything goes okay, and there's nothing more I can say. I'm sure a lot of people will be saying the same thing, but there's few people that we can say are angels, and Mrs. Eversley is definitely, definitely an angel. So she has to go back home. And she will always organise them when she gets over there, especially Sydney. So I just wish you all the best for today and hope everything goes okay. I'm just sorry we can't all be there now, but we wish you all the very, very best. Thank you. Bye.
Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, when Christ shall come with shouts of and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open. We shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are preparing to start off our service in the next 30 seconds, I would say. So be prepared. For the procession, I'll be reading until I get to the top of this aisle. And then we'll start a song that's not on your program, so follow the multimedia in front of you. How great is our God? We are establishing God's greatness and presence amongst us today. Thank you. eternal God is our refuge, and underneath us everlasting arms. Would you stand, please? Thank you. Now is Christ risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor shall not be in vain in the Lord. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We shall sing that song, How Great is Our God, establishing God's presence and his greatness amongst us. Thank you.
Stands. Hallelujah. Yes, age to age. to this service of praise and thanksgiving for our beloved sister, Pearline. I'm sure that those of you who are familiar with Pearline would know that she was the kind of person who was very bubbly. So therefore, we want to sing to the honor and glory of God, recognizing God's presence. Dearly beloved, we are gathered today to pay our final tribute of respect to that which was mortal of our dearly loved one and friend. To you members of the family who mourn your loss, we especially offer our deep and sincere sympathy. And may we share with you the comfort afforded by God's words for such a time as this. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold and not another. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we carry nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Lord, make me to know my end and the number of my days, that I may be certified how long I have to live. Behold, thou hast made my days as they were a span long, and my age is even as nothing in respect of thee. And verily, every man living is altogether vanity. I want to take this opportunity to express my sincere condolences to the family of our sister Pearline. She was always mindful to inform me that I'm related to her. And I see Wendy up front. I'm sure that all of us would have come from the most beautiful parish in Barbados, St. George. And so therefore, it's such an honor for me to have been asked to share in this funeral service. We are going to sing to the honor and glory of God. We want to represent Pearline as well as we possibly can. We're going to sing very well, Precious Lord.
Precious Memory.
Precious Memory, sorry. Precious Memory, Unseen Angels, sent from somewhere to my soul. How they linger ever near me and the sacred past unfold. Precious Memory. The worship team, they're going to lead us in this beautiful hymn.
Be mindful that this is our favorite song. Song over and over and over. So let's sing it in her memory, please. Thank you.
Greetings. I'd just like to say thank you for everyone who's attended today to celebrate the life of Mrs. Pearline Berinda Eversley. For those of you that have not had the pleasure of meeting me, I'd like to introduce myself as Leon Eversley, the eldest of five grandsons and the father of Pearline's two great-granddaughters who reside in England. Before I read the psalm, I just want to take a moment to recognize the importance of nurturing relationships, especially across distances. It's never too late to reconnect with family, friends, and even God. I want you to join me as I read Psalm 23, which I've actually come to understand is a favorite of my grandmother Pearline. You're more than welcome to read along if you're familiar. And I'll get started. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads beside me the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Your rod and your staff comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you. Amen.
I'm going to ask the family members of our sister to gather around the casket at this time. And to pray for the family is a very distinguished person in the Church of the Nazarene, Reverend Dr. Schofield Eversley, one of our former district superintendents, also former president of our college in Trinidad. I am very pleased to have a very distinguished lady in our congregation, Marcel Rodeclar. I hope she does not make mention of that on her program with her boyfriend next week. Say that I called her name out. Can I ask the family members to gather a little closer to the casket so that we can lift you before God at this time? Now I know you've been standing for a little while, and I suspect that those of you who want to sit, I would give you the opportunity to be seated at this time.
Before I lead this prayer, I want to just express a few words here. If I don't do that, I know that Pearlene will come back for me tonight. And I don't want that. Pearlene, and note what I'm saying carefully. Pearlene was more vocally speaking the cousin to me than Sydney was. So much so I called her all the time Cousin Pearlene. Any activity that Pearlene would be responsible for, she will make sure, any official activity that is, she will make sure that Schofield and Margaret are present. If there's someone to be responsible for the remarks for the occasion, I will be that one. We will surely miss Cousin Pearl. She has been a tremendous woman. She was one of those women who ministered to Jesus Christ during his earthly economy of their substance. I consider her ministry that as substance ministry. And that is very indicative of by this response we have today for this service. Our deepest condolences to you, Wendy, and other members of the family from Schofield and Margaret and the children and the Eversleys on a whole. Pearlene was very special to us. And if any time this evening you see me take on my kerchief and begin to wipe while sitting on the platform, don't worry about it. I am Schofield Eversley. And when I move by emotion, I will give vent. You know, some of us men are so macho, we can't do that. But this Schofield Eversley does and will when it becomes necessary. I would like you all to stand, please, with me as we have this brief prayer at this time. Almighty God, how we thank you for being here with us today. This scene is not new to you, for when you tread the earth in the human flesh, We are told that you were touched with the feelings, the infirmities. You touched with the feelings when you came to scenes like this. As a matter of fact, we are told that at one time you wept. God, I pray that you will draw near to these family members today. Pearlene was special to each one of us in so many different ways. Lord, I pray for your strength. I pray for your courage. I pray for your wisdom. I pray, God, that you will truly address us as we stand before you today on behalf of Pearlene. Lord, I pray that you will help her family members to always take note who she would have been. And even though she is gone, may they endeavor to emulate the kind of life that Pearlene would have lived before us. May your continued blessings and benediction rest upon us today. And Father, even though we are in the midst of sorrow, yet may we revel in the fact, and may there be joy whenever Pearl comes to our minds, who she was. And we know, God, she represented you well here. And we know, Father, that you're going to reward her richly. And your reward is that which cannot be taken away from any man, but your reward is that which will stand for all eternity. And Pearlene will stand in the eternity, proud child of God, because she acknowledged you while this side of heaven. May the presence of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit continue to rest upon us. In your name we ask. Amen. God bless you.
You can all sit.
This day we're going to be having this very special tribute in song by the Senior Friendship Choir. After the choir is completed, I'm going to ask Mr. Danny Eversley to come, and he's going to read it for us, a poem.
Good afternoon to each and every one. I just want to pay a tribute to our dear sister, Sister Eversley. I've known her over the years here at Kilmarnock. Now, Sister Eversley was a very meticulous lady, one who loved the Lord, one who loved to sing. And Sister Eversley formed choir here. It's not all that you're seeing here. Some have departed, God rest them. But we decided to continue in what she has left. One of the songs that she loved tremendously is the song that we are going to render to you till the storms passes by. So on behalf of the Senior Friendship Group, the Senior Friendship Choir, the member who really is in charge, no, Sister Veronica Bishop Nurse, our president, we extend our deepest condolences to the family and friends of Sister Eversley till the storms passes by.
Thank you.
Danny, everything's going to read for us.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming. I'm Danny Eversley, the middle of all five grandsons, and I will be reading a poem called Do Not Stand By My Grave and Weep by Mary Elizabeth Fry. Do not stand by my grave and weep. I am not there. I do not sleep. I am the thousand winds that blow. I am the diamond glints in snow. I am the sunlight on ripened grain. I am the gentle autumn rain. As you awake with morning's hush, I am the swift uplifting rush of quiet birds in circling flight. I am the day transcending night. Do not stand by my grave and cry. I am not there. I did not die. Thank you.
At this time, we're going to stand for this hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. seated. I am going to ask both Wendy and John Eversley to come, and they are going to share with us the eulogy.
Never been told I'm too tall before. Good afternoon, everyone. You can all hear me all right? Good, good. To introduce myself, I'm John Eversley. Those of you here will know me as the other son from overseas. To my right is Wendy Lashley, who probably needs no introduction. And we're here and we hope to deliver a loving tribute to Pearline Berinda Eversley, otherwise known as Mum or
Sister. Sister.
Thank you. So whatever you called her, whether it was Grandma, Auntie, Sis, Mrs. E, P, Pearl, Pearline, or Sister Eversley, or choir leader, a lot of you had a lot of affection for Mum. I mean, that's, I can see that today, and that is in abundance. Most of you will have shared lots of moments with her. She lived for 84 years, so that's lots of moments that people will have shared. And I'm hoping the next 10 minutes, you can share some of those thoughts and you can take some of those away with you today. Hopefully there'll be some new ones that we can share with you. As I say, we only have 10 minutes before Pastor Holder pulls me off. So we sort of better get going, really. What a fantastic life. What a fantastic life. You know, my mum was a wonderful lady. You've already heard that from so many people already. She made a huge impact on so many people and so many lives. She touched a lot of people. And I really don't know how we can do her justice in just the 10 minutes, but we will try. To try and make it simple for us today, what we did was we broke her time into three chapters for you, if you like, today. The first part is growing up in retreat and Newbury and her time in Barbados. That's part one. Part two is when she came up to Birmingham in the UK. And of course, the third part is when she came back to this wonderful, wonderful place in Barbados, and she, you know, shared lots of different moments here. So first, I'm going to hand to Wendy, who's going to talk about her childhood.
Pearline Berinda Lashley was born on May 5th, 1939. The second child to Ethlyn and Seymour Lashley. For a short time, they moved from retreat where they were, where these two were born, to Newbury, but that was just a short-lived time, and then they moved back to retreat. So I really can't give you a first-hand account of the mischief that they got into when they lived in Newbury. I tried to pick my older sister Wilma's brain to get some stuff, but she was a little hedgy on what she would share. I do know that when they were told not to leave the house, they did, thinking they could get back before the parents did. And when they didn't get back in time, Wilma, being the oldest, would have been told, you should have known better. And so she would have been the one to bear the brunt of the mischief that they had done. I do have some memories of retreat Pearline, along with her two sisters, the older sister Wilma and the younger sister Emily, for those who know her from her days in Toronto, and Emile, for those who knew her from school, and Miley, for the rest of us. The three of them went to St. Augustine's Girls' School. I was too young to be in school at that time, because I came along a lot later. Reverend Elcock made reference to us being family and so on, and he did mention my name because he's even younger than I am. So we and Reverend Schofield and I would have been little children in Sunday school when they were teenagers in the youth. We will get to that a little bit later. At the St. Augustine's Girls' School was where Pearline's love of family and willingness to defend at any cost came out. Wilma shared with me an incident where what we would call today the school bully attempted to beat up Miley. And Pearline stepped in and reminded this lady, this girl, if you ever touch any of my sisters, this is what will happen to you. And apparently, this person never touched either the older sister or the younger sister after that. She just put her in her place. In spite of the fact that she knew by fighting what the consequences would be. Those of you who are in here who went to St. Augustine's Girl, and I saw a few of you, you knew that Mrs. Campbell's strap would come off and Pearline would have got what Mrs. Campbell would say she deserved for fighting. But she didn't let that deter her from defending her sisters. That was true love and willingness to defend family members. After school, Pearline went to learn what they used to call then needlework or sewing in Superlative, which was not very far from Rock Hall where Sydney lived. And I think that's where the flame started. They wouldn't admit that, but I think that's where it started. We all attended the Newbury Church of the Nazarene, and I look on this platform and two of the pastors that are officiating this ceremony came out of that church. And they that was a church that within the Church of the Nazarene in Barbados at the time was the going place to be. I will read you a tribute from Miley, our middle sister, who cannot be here, and she makes references to the Newbury Church of the Nazarene. She's not here because she just lost her husband of 55 years a few months ago, and so was not strong enough to be able to be here today. So she sent this tribute, and I'm going to read it. She said, I'm extremely grateful for the life that I shared with my sister Pearline and the rest of my family. The bond we forged in childhood has lasted through our old age. This bond was forged because of our mother, Ethelyn Lashley, who taught us what was important in life, love, and how we treat each other. One of my favorite memories, she says, was walking together with Pearline to youth choir practice at the Newbury Church of the Nazarene on Friday nights, which was youth nights. And she said, I sang soprano, Pearline sang alto. And as you all know, Pearline's love of singing continued right up to her death. So Emily says that that was one of her fondest memories. And I, at her and Sydney's 50th wedding anniversary, I heard this anecdote again about the Newbury Church of the Nazarene. Sydney would ride from Rock Hall to Newbury on Friday nights, poke his head into the window, make sure Pearline was there. Then he would write a note, signal to a mutual friend to come out and get this note, and then Rita would take this note back to Pearline. And as you know, the rest is history. In 1957, as an older teenager, Pearline left Barbados to join Sydney in England.
This is where I pick up the story. I'm really proud of Mom, and I'm really proud of, well, her and Dad and their resilience. If you think of the situation this way, before Christmas in 1957, I think the furthest my mum had ever journeyed was the 7 miles into Bridgetown. A few weeks later, she was on a 4,500 miles journey to meet my dad via a plane, and then to get on a boat for weeks and weeks and weeks. And I know how much she enjoyed being at sea. And then she had to go and face the cold and the snow and the ice, and as well as sometimes a frosty and hostile reception or atmosphere. We all know the story, how hard it was at the very beginning for people from the West Indies up in England. So it was tough for her, but it was absolute resilience. She really stuck with it, and you know, Colin and I are sort of testament to that. So Mum and Dad got married in 1958, so soon after she went up to England, and I came along probably a bit too quickly later the same year. And so I think I probably got in the way of some of their plans, but in the path of well-trodden first generation people in North America and the United Kingdom, I came back to Barbados. So that's how I got my love for Barbados. I came back as a baby to spend time with my grandmothers. Both are already up there waiting for Mum. The purpose of me coming back was so that Mum and Dad could spend a lot of time, and they did spend a lot of time, and they worked really hard to get their first house. So they bought their first house in what we affectionately remember as 123 Medlicott Road. I know there's one or two neighbours up here. I saw the Kings at the top who were around the corner. And they were the first black family on the road, on that street. So I'm immensely proud of some of the things they did to give Colin and I a real start in life. That house was absolutely full of love. They were there for many, many years. I'll talk about that in a second. But Colin came along, 1966. So it was a few years after I came back, from Barbados back up to England. And so Colin came along, and that helped us to create that family home of which we all look back with real fondness. Mum, as I said, worked really hard. She did works in engineering. She was doing part-time jobs. She worked at the Birmingham General Hospital. Some people will remember that here, maybe. And so she worked there for quite a while. And in all the places she worked, she built up a real army of friends. In fact, friends and friendship absolutely defined what Mum was all about. Someone mentioned in the tributes earlier, I think it was Angela Francis, mentioned the trips to Preston, Blackpool, all over the UK. Mum used to organise trips. She organised social gatherings. She used to organize, as I said, all sorts of occasions. I think she's very instrumental in getting some of the social events for the, I can't remember the full words now, but it's the Barbados Friends and Family Association up in the United Kingdom, pulling them all together into one community so that they all could remain connected. And that connection and friendship was absolutely key to what she was all about. I've received many tributes in the last 2 or 3 weeks from people across the UK, and that's all a testament to the affection that people held for her. Her last weeks in Birmingham culminated really in a big send-off. As usual, Dad was nowhere to be seen. He was already here. He jumped on the plane and came down here and said, that's it, I'm not coming back up. Mom had a big send-off. There was a lot of people came out to wish her well. She had a big party up in Moseley. Some of you might have been there. Certainly I remember it. And so she had a solo celebration, exclusive night, all to herself. And a lot of fun was had by all. So then we move to the last part, which I think is probably the moment that she cherished most. She had always looked forward to coming back to Barbados. And after 37 years in England, she'd had enough of the cold and the winter. And so she came back to Barbados. And as we know, she's lived here for another 29 years. In that time, I think those 29 years were filled with accomplishments and achievements. There was a lot of joy, a lot of love, and she touched a lot of people. The thing I know that she really enjoyed about coming back home was spending some time with my grandmothers, Muz to some, and Doris on the other side. And so those were very important to her because that was all about the love and the family. She spent a lot of time getting involved in the community here. She gave generously of her time. She was very supportive, if you like, in volunteering to help with funds for organizations like the Thelma Vaughan Home. You might know that from here. At the Barbados Diabetic Association, I know she was also very proud to represent. Talking of pride, I know she was extremely proud to have been nominated as one of the 11 ladies that went to the Prime Minister's Mother's Day reception back in 2009. It was on the front cover of the Nation newspaper, and I know how proud she was because she sent me 3 different copies in the course of a week. So, and I still have them. That's how I remember the date. She enjoyed life here in Barbados. I know she really enjoyed the friendship group and the senior choir. That was core to her. She used to tell me when she went out, and I still have we still have lots of hymn sheets and song sheets and orders of service that she was involved with, that they're still all at the house, and Colin knows that because he's sitting on quite a few of them. She had a phone book of friends here on the island, and I am indebted to you all for welcoming her back as a returning national and sharing the love that she shared here. Hythe Gardens became an absolute haven to her. She opened the doors, she welcomed everyone. She particularly built up a loving home here where she could welcome. When we came back, Josh and Danny would come in and she would open arms. Miles and Jonathan just up the road, they could pop round any time and spend time with Grandma. And I know she would dearly have loved to have caught up with Leon, but never mind, she can see you here today. She's looking down, and she would be looking down today, and she'd be so proud and pleased to see all 5 of her grandsons here in the front row at the church. I've gone on too long. I'm going to finish with some of this now. The last story that I really wanted to tell was, I was trying to find a way of finishing today, and I came across this, which is, it's a program for the Senior Friendship Group 5th Anniversary 2003. I found it when I was clearing some things the other day. The theme was friendship, love and unity. Those 3 words absolutely represented what my mother was all about, the love she had, the friendships that she built, and she dug really hard to try and create that unity. And so if you think of 3 things today, think of friendship, love, unity, and think of my mom. traveling up to meet my dad. He will be waiting there with her, sat on the veranda in a chair. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you both, Colin and Wendy, for sharing with us tribute on behalf of our sister Pearline. I'm sure that there are some things we would not have known had they not shared with us this evening. I'm going to ask Colin if he would come at this time and share with us tribute.
Good afternoon, congregation. Good afternoon, everybody that's online, watching around the Caribbean and the globe. Tobago, Grenada, St. Kitts and Nevis. I'm missing out somebody, Jamaica, for sure. England, it's hot, because I've been checking it online and I'm watching the streaming and seeing what's going on. I thank you all for being tuned in. I just want to read this message on the front cover because it's so much my mother. Always so good, unselfish, and kind. True on this earth, her equal we find. Honorable and upright in all her ways. Loyal, and I said that loud for a reason. Loyal and true to the end of her days. I just want to explain, because a lot of people may not have had the privilege of knowing what happened with Mom. Mom became ill the end, well, some part of last year. I was there for Mom, because John is in England, so I'm the only body left. I'm here. I was given the task of taking care of Mom. I had no choice. I rolled up my sleeves and I did what I had to do. I had a lot of help. I even declined help. But I want to say some thank yous as well. This is a tribute and a thank you. I want to thank personally Cynthia, Chantel, and Vashti from the National Assistance Board, the Home Help. They helped tremendously in being a companion towards my mother, and I really appreciate the help that you've all done. There was also a neighbor who, from the get-go, showed me the way, because I don't know nothing. I don't know how to use a blood pressure machine. I don't know how to use a sugar testing machine. I know nothing, but I had no choice but to learn it. And everybody tells me I did a good job. But I'm going to fast forward to Friday, the 23rd of February. I did not see this day coming. A lot of people don't know this, but Mom actually died in my arms. She did it her way. That is how she wanted it. She didn't want it any other way. She died in my arms. So it's a privilege. That to me, she died comfortable. She was in a lot of pain, but she wouldn't admit it. Her most famous words were, "I'm all right. I'm okay." Is that true? She would tell you that, "I'm all right. I'm okay." But she wasn't. She just didn't want to worry anybody. That's how she was. But I want to thank each and every one of you. I've got a lot of support. I did not realize how much I meant to a lot of people. The kind words, whether you sent it on WhatsApp, email. I have to apologize for one thing. There's a lot of people that are not very happy with me for not answering the telephone at the house. But I had to make a decision, answer the phone or deal with my mom. I think most of you would deal with your mother. The phone can wait. Not even my cell phone got my attention. Anybody that knew me knew to send me a message. I would respond, but I had to give mom my full attention. So I apologize for not answering the phone. And by the way, I'm still not gonna answer the phone after tonight. That's just how it is. But I thank each and every one of you for showing all the love and the support to myself, to my brother John, and the rest of the family. I really appreciate everybody. Love you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Colin. Can I ask you to stand with me at this time as we sing that beautiful hymn, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. And while this hymn is being sung, we are going to be receiving a very special offering. This offering is just not an offering. We want to treat this offering as though it's a contribution to the church. Let's all stand, please. You're giving this offering to the church here at Columbia Rock on Sister Pearline's behalf. So we want you to give as generously as you possibly can, because this is the only way Pearline would have known how to do it. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
This is my story. This is my
us prayer. Father, we want to give your name honor, glory, and praise. We thank you for the gifts that you've given to us. Thank you for those persons who have been able to make a contribution as it relates to this offering. We are asking you, divine God, that you will continue to bless us and continue to afford us the opportunity that we can give to your service. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I'm going to ask Mr. Josh Eversley if he would come at this time, and he is going to be reading for us 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. Thessalonians 4, 13 through 18, and Josh Eversley will read it for us.
Good afternoon, everyone. For those that don't know me, my name is Josh Eversley, grandson of Pearline and John's elders. I'm now going to read the 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet in the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, Josh, for reading for us God's word. To share with us this evening from God's word is my friend, my colleague, and I feel very proud to be able to identify with this gentleman, one of the most senior ministers in the Church of the Nazarene on this Barbados district. He's also the senior minister here at the Culmer Rock Church of the Nazarene. I want to invite the Reverend David Holder, B.S., as you will see on your sheet, to share with you this evening from the Word of God. My brother.
Thank you so much, Dr. Elka, and I have to say thank you publicly, because only this afternoon I asked if he would chair the service. I recognized my voice was not going to be very good, and I actually wanted to ask him to speak, but then I felt I should preach despite the voice. So I really want to thank him for holding the fort for me, and let me say good afternoon to everyone. Good afternoon, despite the fact that we're in the face of death, we are celebrating the life of a life well lived. And, you know, I was trying to think of a word to describe Sister Eversley. I didn't write it down, but she was certainly an extraordinary woman and certainly touched your lives, my life, and the lives of so many others who are not here this afternoon. You know, she came in this church at a very interesting time. We had just gone about some changes. And I recognize, that in going about the changes that we were implementing, the older folks will be kind of like put on the side. In other words, they will not be leading the worship and things that they were doing before. And I was wondering in my mind, what can I do to make these older folks feel special and a part of the church? And it came to my mind, as the Lord will lead me, to create what is now called the Senior Friendship ministry or group. I had a particular lady in mind to lead this group. She she's passed, a good leader herself. And I spoke to her, she said yes, but she didn't say yes. She said she would think about it. And that took a whole year, but it never came back to me. And I felt, okay, let's move on. And Sister Pearlie came to church just around that time. And I just went to her and said, you know, I feel led to ask you to, I'm going to start a group, I would like you to lead it. And she said, yes, I used to do this in England. And so it is, that has become history. For 12 years, she led this group. She led it as a strong leader. She led the choir. She had a baton and everything. And they were well involved all across the Anglican church and various churches and the people harvest and all about. I wouldn't be there most of the times. And she'd be telling people, giving greetings on my behalf. I didn't even send the greetings, but she felt she could speak for me anyhow. a woman of real love. Once my birthday came around, I was sure to get what we call a bottle of wine. Now, wine in the Nazarene church is a non-alcoholic. It's not me, a juice drink. It's not really wine in itself, but we don't drink. That's why. Really, she will be missed. Really will be missed. A good leader for 12 years, strong leader, and certainly led with distinction. I want to just tie into the, and let me say, this is a long service for me. For funerals, for me, an hour and 10 minutes at the maximum, but we've gone beyond that. But this Pearlie, they have to do this for Pearlie, so you understand. But we're short on my remarks. From the scripture just read just now, the last words of that scripture, based on the version you just read, sir, I think it's the new NIV, encourage one another with these words. Or the King James would say, I'm trying to remember the words of King James. Anyhow, the idea of encouraging one another. The question I want to ask, though, how do you find it, how would you find it to be able to encourage anybody in the face of death? What do you say to people when somebody dying? Or when somebody's even dying? You go to the hospital, as they do because of their ministry, and you have to deal with sick people that you can see with your own eyes. They're going. What do you say at that time? And normally, silence is golden at that moment because you might say the wrong thing. But here it is, Paul is writing to a church, and he's talking about life beyond death. We are all going to die. The Bible says that it is appointed unto every man once to die. After that, there's the judgment. So as I heard a preacher say when I was a youngster, there are two appointments we did not make, but we must keep. We are appointed to die. We are appointed to meet the judge, which is Jesus Christ, the righteous one. That is a subject in itself. But what Paul got across to his writers and to us now is that he didn't say not to weep, and I heard Dr. Everything alluding to that. He didn't say not to weep, not to cry. That's natural. In fact, they said that's even healthy. Of course, you cry over and over and over all the time, but that's another story. But it's healthy to cry. But Paul said to the church back then, we do not mourn like those who have no hope. And that is the key there. The question is, do we have the hope? Not just hope, but the hope. You can put that capital H, O, P, and E. Full caps. Jesse Jackson of the Rainbow Coalition often finishes program by saying, keep hope alive. Keep hope alive. Now, of course, that depends on if you have the hope. And the truth is, as human beings, we are all creatures of hope. We need hope. Hope is what spurs us on. I have never seen one for myself. I've read about them in the papers, maybe, of people, or heard other comments, of people committing suicide. And those who took the time to write a note before they did the deed. And normally the note would go in a melancholic way to say, I see no way out. You know, there's no reason to go on. And so they end their lives. People say that's a cowardly way to go. I say it's a brave thing to do because I can't get it done. But that person did that because they lost hope. And I trust that all of us here are indeed enjoying or at least looking forward with hope for certain things. You know, what is so sad about that is that many of us had hopes when we got married. You remember when you got married? The doo-doo darling, the sweetheart, all that. You called them all that then, and then years later you got divorced, and the boy is a dog. The boy has all sorts of names. You know what I'm saying? You know, there's hatred, there's bitterness, there's anger, there's unforgiveness. You're not happy yourself. If you see that person, all sorts of things go through your emotions. You've lost hope in marriage. Desiderata reminds us not to become cynical about love, but not to become cynical also about hope. Some of us are good friends. A good friend. Good friend for 20 years. You know, you trusted them, they trusted you, you went into their space, they went into your space, and then one day after all those years, they betrayed you. And you tell yourself you're entrusting another person in your space again. So you go through life bitter, suspicious, keeping body at arm's length, but you're happy with yourself anyhow. So there are a lot of reasons why a lot of people have lost hope. But I want to say this afternoon, there's a hope that can stand the test of time. Stand any test for that matter. That's the hope that is grounded in Jesus Christ. Not the church, not the pastor, not the people, but in Jesus Christ himself. He's the hope. He's the one to whom we have to anchor our souls, as the book of Hebrews will say, the anchor of our souls, Jesus Christ. You know, our final song says, and I just quote the first verse, I could say it from memory probably, but I'll say it by reading. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. So this evening the question is, do you have the real hope, the true hope, the lasting hope, the only hope that really keeps? And that is the hope that comes from God through Jesus Christ. If your life is not anchored in Christ this evening, all that you're hoping in, all that you're trusting in, all that you put your confidence in is very transitory, it's very temporary, and can change any moment. You know, one of the lessons that COVID taught us, COVID-19 as it was called, is called, is that life could be a peach today, going well, and then the rug can be pulled from under you, and you're flat on your back. People lost jobs. People lost lives. People lost loved ones. People lost a lot. People have not even recovered yet in many ways because of one epidemic. And who knows what the future holds. And so if you're putting your trust in the politicians or in the world or in the United Nations or whatever it might be, my friends, you're standing on shaky ground. There's only one solid place we can place our hope. That is, again, in Jesus Christ. And that's what Paul's getting across. Sister Pearline wasn't just a phenomenal woman. That's the word I want to use. Phenomenal. It all comes to mind. But one of the reasons and main reason why she was that sort of woman is that she was in Jesus Christ. This woman left Barbados, went to England. Many people left Barbados, went to England. Some came back, admittedly, even mad. That's a fact. Some came back telling us, you still believe in that kind of thing? Yeah, Sister Pony held her faith in England, in Barbados, in England, back in Barbados. She kept her faith. That's why a lot of you are here, because her faith made her the phenomenal woman that she became. And I want to invite you. It's all to stop with the memories, but the memories better yet fixed if our memories are based on the fact that she put her life in Christ and you will put yours in Jesus Christ as well. Now you're making sense. Because Paul said in this letter, one day Jesus shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ. And then you go back in that scripture again. While it does use the word dead in Christ at that point, go back earlier. It talks about those who sleep in Jesus. I think all of us went to sleep last night. Even if you were watching me, you probably started a little sleep. But when you went to sleep, what you expecting next? To wake up. However you got it, whether it was a rooster crow, you still have some of those, or the dog bark, or somebody came through a scrambler, or your wife woke you, or your children jump, or your grandchildren, whatever the case might be. You got them in here, or you're glad to be up too. But the Bible says, yes, when the Christian dies, as we call it, when the Christian are dead, as we call them, the Bible says, no, they are resting until Jesus descends and shout and call them forth to be with him forever. Amen. That is the hope of the Christian. Do you have that hope? You know, if you were to take time, you may be cynical about Christianity, for instance. That's all in itself. But if you take time to study all the other faiths, Muslim, Hindu, philosophy of Confucianism, and all the others, Buddhism, none, and then science, and those who are atheists and all that, study all what they have to say, read what they have to say, learn what they have to learn, the science that we should learn. None of it stands up to the person called Jesus Christ. More books written about this man than any other man. Think it for a while. How many men you know books are written about? There may be a book about a biography about a particular fellow that has sold maybe a few million. But here's a man that all types of people wrote about him. Some for him, some against him. But he writes. There's a man that music is written about. No, I'm trying to think in my mind. Who else do we write or read music about? Bob Marley wrote music, but do we write music about Bob Marley? Think of it. I just use the name for the sake of using the name. Popular person. Jesus Christ has plowed into history, dividing it from BC to AD, and he stands as the only one supreme. He died, he arose, and because of his resurrection and his coming, that is where we have our hope. No other faith offers a hope like that. And I trust this evening as I close, that somebody will ponder on those words and think about it, that Jesus, as the late, who was with my next, lower down neighbor used to say, Jesus is the answer for the world today. I trust you will trust Jesus. Would you say amen with me? Would you stand as well? My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. And I want to take the time as well to offer my personal, sincerest condolences to you, Colin, John, and all family members, Wendy. I really wish you God's strength as you go forward. Yes, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in that morning that God has laid aside for his people. I just want you to continue to carry out those virtues that Sister Eversley displayed. Live them out. That's the best way to keep her memory. Living her virtues out. God's blessings attend to you. And do remember that I'm here in Barbados. If you're in England or wherever, or here in Barbados, if you need me, you can call me, you can find me. I'm available to be there for you as well. I'm coming down as we sing. She said, in living the faith. Now it beholds us, O God, having seen and know what we should do, to do likewise. I pray for our family very specially, Lord, that your hand of grace, benediction, and kindness will attend to them. May they too take on the faith of mother and sister to follow through in Jesus. May your blessings attend to them now. May you dry their tears. May you give them strength and your peace that passeth understanding. And may the joy of the Lord indeed become their strength. In the name of Jesus. For each one in this congregation, Father, speak to our hearts. Remind us of our own mortality. Remind us that this hour will come to us and it beholds us as wise people to be prepared for death and for eternity. Thank you, each one gathered. And in everything, Father, may you receive all glory, honor, and praise. We worship and give praise and give thanks in Jesus' name. And the people say, amen. Amen. Paul Burns, would you come, please? Use this song as a recession song when the poor bills are ready. All those with the roses, please advance. Your undivided attention, ladies and gentlemen. Man that is born of woman have but a short time to live and is full of misery. He cometh up and is cut down like a flower. He flieth as it were a shadow and never continueth in one stay. In the midst of life, we are in death. Of whom may we seek for succor but of thee, O Lord, who for our sins art justly displeased. Thou knowest, Lord, the secrets of our hearts. Shut not the merciful ears to our prayers, but spare us, Lord most holy, O God most mighty, O holy and merciful Savior, thou most worthy judge eternal, suffer us now at our last hour of repentance of death to fall from thee. For as much as I have pleased Almighty God in his wise providence to take out of this world the soul of the deceased sister, even the late Pearline Berinda Eversley, we therefore commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Looking for the general resurrection in the last day and the life of the world to come through our Lord Jesus Christ, our whose second coming in glorious majesty to judge the world, the earth and the sea shall give up their dead, and the corruptible bodies of those who sleep in him shall be changed and made like unto his glorious body, according to the mighty working, whereby he is able to subdue all things unto himself. Amen. Let us also do the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, right, blessed are the dead, for they shall indeed rest from their labors. May she indeed rest in peace. Amen. Gravesite song. Our gravesite songs are, have we all get to heaven? Shall we get out the river? Because he lives. I want us to sing it in that order backward. Because he lives. First, when we start, not yet, when the burial actually begins. And we will hold the last song as the last thing that we will do after the wreaths at our place and we have our benediction. The last song in the program is going to be sung at that time. So if you run out of songs before the grave is covered, you can always raise another song, whether from the ones in the church or otherwise, like As Well My Soul, things like that. Thank you. We shall begin by singing because he lives. Let me all get to heaven. So because he lives, and there shall we gather. So somebody start us, please. Thank you. God sent his son. They are called the Jesus. Sing his past over here. Sing it. Shall we get out of the room? Thank you for singing. Shall we get out of the room? Thank you.
Thank you so much. The last one, the last one.
appreciation of the Father.
Thank you. on my workers.
She's traveling.
Your attention, I want to give the benediction for the family and for all others. And then that final song, God Will Take Care of You, which I dedicate to the family going forward from here. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord mercifully and graciously cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you to grant each one of you his grace, peace, mercies, and blessings through Jesus Christ our Lord. And let all the people say in one voice, Amen. Amen. I do wish you a good afternoon and a better tomorrow with God's help. Trust the Lord going forward. God be with you. Choir, God will take care of you. And don't try again, please.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord.